Right? So let's think with Augustine. What would a Christian culture or a Christian education be invested in? How would you talk about that? Augustine starts this way. He says, I'm going to hand on to students some rules, some precepts for understanding or treating scripture. So there's a clue. That is, a Christian culture in some way is going to be invested in the interpretation of scripture. And he says, there are two things which all treatment of scriptures are aiming at. A way to discover what needs to be understood, and a way to speak forth to others what you have understood. So think about it, friends. It's like research and teaching, right? Inquiry, seeking to understand, and then communication, or teaching, or even preaching, helping someone else to understand. And the two things are related, aren't they, friends? Because if you really want to teach something to somebody, you really have something you love, and you want them to understand it, you're going to try to study it in a way that you find a way to put it across. You're going to try to seek understanding in a way that engenders understanding. So there's the kind of culture we're aiming at, to seek to understand scripture and to help others understand it too, and to seek in a way that helps others. Now you might think this is a really narrow focus for a whole culture, interpretation of scripture. But actually what it means is everything scripture teaches, so everything God has revealed. So Christian culture, Christian education is a conversation, a new kind of conversation about what God has revealed, about what we wouldn't know unless God had revealed it. For example, that God loves us. You wouldn't know that from philosophy. Sorry, philosophers, but you wouldn't. God has to tell us, I love you. And that's what scripture does. And all the teachings that are associated with that simple revelation. So Christian culture is a conversation about, or really you could say, ordered to trying to understand these mysteries that scripture reveals and trying to help others understand them. Okay so far? Okay. So what does scripture teach? It teaches a lot of beautiful things. Augustine says that the teaching of the scriptures are summed up in the creeds, which he calls the rule of faith. But things like this, the incarnation, the passion of Christ, his death and resurrection, all of which are enabling to help us to love God and to help us to love neighbor. Okay, now ready for a major distinction? This is like a super famous one. It's going to sound obvious, but it's actually very famous. Augustine makes a distinction between things and signs. All right, the things, we've already given some examples of them. What things does scripture teach? What things are revealed? What are we trying to understand? Things like the resurrection of Christ, his incarnation, his passion, what it means, etc. But things are communicated about or learned about through signs. So there's the major distinction. Got that? Things, signs. Seems obvious, right? But don't dismiss it right away as something that everyone's already thought of. Augustine chooses to focus on this distinction. All teaching, all doctrina, all culture is about signs or things. But things are learned through signs. Friends, think about it. This opens up a space, doesn't it? Between signs. Signs mean language, it means words, it means how we convey what we're trying to teach, the things we're trying to teach. But Augustine focuses on the distinction because it opens up a space between how we talk about something and the thing itself. And therefore, opens up a potential space between culture and reality, between the sort of the way that language treats reality and reality itself. This is evident, you could say, in examples of contemporary discussions of abortion. It's a good example. Is it a heartbeat or is it an electrical impulse? Is it a baby or is it something else? The same reality is being referred to, but you see how the signs that you use to refer to it can, in a way, come between the reality or and the hearer, or it can bring out the reality. So this is why Augustine focuses on this distinction between things and signs. We can't just give a person the thing. Well, I can give you this, a book. But unless I tell you what it is, you're not gonna. Okay, got that on things and signs? Yes? Fantastic. Okay, one more thing about signs. Augustine puts it this way. Signs are what living creatures give one another in order to indicate whatever they have sensed or understood. And he goes on to say, in a passage that's too long to quote here, they're born in the intention to signify, right? So a sign is something I use because I intend to signify something, to communicate something, right? So it's born in my will to communicate. And what does that mean, friends? Think about it. It means that there's no way of neutrally conveying information. You can't just tell people information in a value-free way. Every act of communication which uses signs is always going to carry with it the will or the love in which that sign is intended. I'll give you an example. I'm going to say the same sentence twice, and we're going to convey the same information. Do you know what a fountain pen is? I know they're, like, a lot of people don't use them anymore, but they're the ones that actually have ink. Okay, so I could say this. I love fountain pens. Or it could be that I was just using a fountain pen and I got ink all over myself. And I would say, I love fountain pens. See, I said the same thing. I used the same signs about the same thing, but I communicated a completely different will or love, right? So this is Augustine's like key insight and why he distinguishes signs from things, because every time you communicate, every time we use signs, we don't only communicate information, we communicate the love with which we form the sign. And we teach both at the same time. So if you're trying to run a class on fountain pens, which would be really stupid, but let's go with the flow, I could run a class in which I'm trying to sell you on fountain pens, right? I could tell you all about them, very accurately, how they work, et cetera. And I could run the same class, tell you the same things in which I'm trying to persuade you it's an outmoded technology, don't bother using it. But I would give you the same facts. It's just that how I love them is I'm teaching that too. I'm teaching you to have that love. Okay, is that clear? Did I explain that clear enough? Yes? Okay. And the main category of signs is words. So words, after all, are far and away the principal means used by human beings to signify the thoughts they have in their minds when anyone ever wishes to express them. So words are the currency of culture, the currency of educational environments. Words can be spoken words, like I'm speaking now. They can be gestures. The gestures are significant in that sense, are a word. Words are very malleable. I've already given you an example. You can use words to get across truth and reality, or you can use words to distort them, to substitute a fake reality for what is actually real. So, because it's so much in the news, the issue of abortion comes to mind again. You can create a whole culture, right, based on the idea that a baby isn't a baby, that the fetus isn't a baby, that it's not a human life, and that it doesn't have a heartbeat, it just has electrical impulses, which is, of course, all heartbeats are electrical impulses. And you can kind of create a culture which replaces the reality, right, in which you don't want to see a baby anymore. You don't use the language anymore. You don't use the language of heart. You don't use any of these. So in some ways, you've replaced the reality by the signs that you're using. See the point? Augustine has a special word for that move. He calls it pride. Pride. In English, pride is kind of a positive word sometimes. You can be proud of your accomplishments. But the Latin word superbia is an evil word. It's like pride means what? It means I want to be God. I want to replace God with myself. But how do I do that? I don't do it by saying, hey, look at me, I'm God. It's like somebody can say, get a grip, John. Yeah, you have a PhD, but that doesn't make you God. We don't do it that way. We do it by using words to replace the reality that God created with an artificial construct. And we do that through culture. So we can create cultures which actually are intended to displace reality, to displace what God created. And that is our way of playing God. That's our way, in a sense, of being a creator. We've created this whole reality. It has nothing to do with what's real, but that doesn't matter. We're the ones who created it. So praise us, me. Okay, so what do you need then to understand Scripture? Especially since all of us in a fallen world are coming from this position that Augustine calls pride. There's all kinds of ways in which we tend to substitute by our speech something we prefer to be true rather than something which is true. So how do we approach Scripture? Well, he says the first thing, you have to have the right attitude. What is needed above all else is to be converted by the fear of God to wishing to know his will, what he asks us to seek and what to avoid. What is needed next is piety. We should rather think and believe that what is written there in Scripture is better and truer, even if its meaning is hidden, than any good idea we can think of for ourselves. So these two attitudes, fear of God, so that we don't, in other words, we don't immediately assume that we're right, and we're not afraid, possibly, that we're wrong. And then piety means an attitude towards Scripture which accepts its authority, which is willing to, even if it seems like something we don't like at the outset, just willing to look farther, because a lot of its meaning, Augustine says, it's hidden. Why would its meaning be hidden in some cases? Think about it for a second, friends. The incarnation is God's emptying himself, right? God has all the power and all the prestige. Whoa. But he comes among us having taken flesh, having taken not just flesh, but flesh is always in a culture, flesh is always in a, you know, born into a language. He becomes just like we are, liable to death, just like we are, even though he's sinless. So the incarnation is an emptying. You could say God empties himself of his prestige. It's an act of humility. He comes among us. He empties himself so far that he becomes a baby dependent on his mother. You know, a regular baby that needs to be nursed and needs to have his butt wiped. Sorry, but it's true. God's been down that far. Okay. What happens in Scripture? Well, after Jesus ascends, it's the apostles who preach, right? Scripture is a kind of continuation, you might say, of the incarnation, because Jesus bends down and empties himself into this text. Think about that. Texts are really vulnerable. They can be mistranslated, they can be badly copied, so that to give us this text is an act of self-emptying love and an act of entrustment. So that's why he's hidden, because he's emptied himself so far as to be in a real text written by real people, not some sort of in some sort of divine language, but in a real language, therefore one that has to be interpreted. So why would we be needing an attitude of piety to find what's hidden? Because we have to trust, because we're proud, we're not going to notice how humble he is, how far down he's emptied himself by becoming text in a way. Is that okay, that little explanation? Did I lose anybody? Just think of self-emptying love. Okay, what else do you need to understand Scripture? There's the right attitude. You need a knowledge of signs. This is why Augustine brings up the distinction. Sometimes it's as simple as this. You need to know languages. Do you know Greek? Well, you better learn it. Or do you know Hebrew? Well, you better learn it. If you really want to know Scripture, of course it's available in translation. But still, you have to know the languages into which it's translated. So, you need to know languages. That's part of Christian doctrine, part of doctrina, Christian education. It draws in all the learning associated with languages. So you see, it's getting to be very sophisticated, isn't it? The more you go, the more you find how sophisticated a culture it actually is. You'll be pleased to know, since you're out of college for 4 years and paying tuition. Okay, but some signs, even when you know the language, some signs are not straightforward. For some reason, they're ambiguous, they're metaphorical, their meaning is hidden, so you need more in order to begin to crack the code, to understand. So for this, friends, you need the liberal arts. You need the human arts and sciences. You need to be able to know something about how the world works in order to know what Scripture is communicating in the various languages and in the presuppositions that it has. For example, you need to know grammar. You need to know how language works. You need to know music meaning poetry, verse. You need to know history, because Scripture invokes a lot of history. You need to know geography. It's presupposed when you read Scripture that you already know it, but we maybe don't know it. You need to know astronomy, it talks about stars. You need to know about dialectic, that's the liberal art that teaches you how to argue and how to make arguments, because Scripture makes arguments. You need to know math. Scripture uses a lot of math. It's not calculus, but still. Rhetoric, oh my God, rhetoric is the art of beautiful and persuasive speech. St. Paul uses it all the time. You need to be able to understand what rhetoric is. So you need all of these various sorts of doctrina, all of these various kinds of teaching, all of these various kinds of learning, and you bring them in, but what happens? Now they're part of a new conversation, right? Which they couldn't have given themselves. All these liberal arts are now ordered towards understanding that God loves us, understanding the mystery, the mysteries of the faith. So they're now all brought into a new conversation which none of them could have had on their own. So we think about integration. We're integrating all of these various disciplines into a conversation about what God has revealed. He says, on the contrary, all good and true Christians should understand the truth, wherever they may find it, belongs to their Lord. So that means If it's true, it can be integrated into this larger conversation. If it's true, even if it didn't come from Christianity, it's still the Lord's, and it's still useful. So you can think of all the stuff the Greeks thought up. They're the ones who thought up dialectic, that is, for example, modes of argumentation, styles of argumentation. Just because it wasn't Christian to start with doesn't mean that's not useful to know about as you bring it in to a conversation which is not just ordered towards winning an argument anymore, but which is ordered towards persuading people of the beauty of something they wouldn't have seen unless you helped them. So see what I mean? If it's true, don't be afraid of it. It can be drawn in because it's true. This is true even of philosophy. I know there's philosophers here. If those who are called philosophers happen to have said anything that is true and agreeable to our faith, the Platonists, he loved the Platonists above all, not only should we not be afraid of them, but we should even claim back for our own use that what they have said. And he compares it to the Israelites. You may not remember this, but in Scripture, in a small passage, but Augustine notices it, he says that the Israelites took with them gold and treasured items that the Egyptians gave them. They took them out of Israel, out of Egypt, and repurposed them. So philosophy is like the highest cultural achievement. That's the gold. Did it start with Christianity? No, it doesn't matter. Gold wasn't invented by Egypt either. But you take it out and repurpose it. Hopefully it's not like repurposing like a gift you didn't like, you know, a birthday gift. Maybe none of you have ever done that. I have. Sorry. Anyway, so we're repurposing the gold of Egypt. Philosophy, after all, is the love of wisdom, right? And guess what, friends? That's always a good love. But what's true wisdom? True wisdom, as Scripture reveals it, is the proclamation that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. And to come to know that more and more intimately, to contemplate it, is true wisdom. Philosophy can help with that project. First of all, by using the language of wisdom itself, and by talking about love of wisdom. So you can bring even that into the conversation. So far, so good? Yes? Okay. Okay, however, there's a however, I know you were waiting for it. On the other hand, Augustine says this: neither the liberal arts nor philosophy on their own can ensure the happy life. The happy life is the ancient way of talking about the life of wisdom. Because if you truly have wisdom, it makes you happy. He says, eager and bright young people, see any? I see them. Eager and bright young people who fear God and are seeking the happy life should not impetuously and unconcernedly pursue any teachings, any doctrina that can be had outside the Church of Christ, as though these could ensure them a happy life. So he's saying, look, even though the liberal arts, and especially philosophy, are pathways to wisdom, pathways to to transcendence, to an awareness of something transcendent, being itself. How's that? Ever heard of that phrase? Even though that's true, they won't make you happy, ultimately. So don't lodge your happiness in them. Why won't they make you happy? Because they don't talk about love. They don't talk about God's love. They don't say that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. And when St. John says the world, he doesn't just mean an abstract thing. He means you and you and you. God so loved me, God forbid, that he sent his only begotten Son. That's what makes you happy, to know that you're that loved. And you can just set aside all the self-hatreds you've been harboring. We have so many of them. And they're so alive in our culture. God so loved the world, and that means so loved you. That's true wisdom. Philosophy and the liberal arts on their own can't get you there. So don't approach them as though they would and will. But remember the other part, take them seriously. Give yourself to them, because insofar as they're true, they can help. So I already covered the next slide, why not? Well, for one thing, what I just said, none of these disciplines can on their own attain to knowledge of the incarnation or other teaching about the love of God, the humility of God. In the De Doctrina, Augustine has a beautiful way of talking about this, that Jesus Christ, who is the Word through whom everything was created, bent down so far as to become the pavement under our feet. Like I'm walking. That's how I go to heaven. I'm walking. He put down the pavement. Guess what? The pavement is himself. That's how far he emptied himself. Kind of gets to you if you think about it. And that has to be revealed. You're not going to read in the Gorgias, right, or in the Republic, God so loved the world that he became the pavement under your feet. Forget it. It's not there. So it has to be revealed. So that's the first reason. But also, friend, there's another reason. And this goes back to what we were saying earlier. It's easy. This is what Augustine says. I'll comment on it. It's very hard to avoid being puffed up by the knowledge of signs in order to be thought learned or well-educated. Maybe you've never encountered this. I'll give you an example. Knowledge of signs, what does that mean? Knowledge of culture, knowledge of all the things we've been talking about. How about this? Guess what? I have a PhD. How's that? Do you? Oh, maybe some of you. But most of you don't. So there. You know what? I'm going to tell you something else. I'll clue you in. God doesn't have one either. How's that? I have more degrees than God. You know how many God has? I'll count them. Zero. So, look at me and praise me. Forget about God. You can't even see him. Gosh, it's like you can't see him, you can't touch him, it's useless. I am smart. I can read Greek. I can scan Aeschylus. I can't really. That's really hard. You know, to read Greek poetry and to be able to read it in meter, called scanning. If you can do that, you can have a little pride. You're looking for praise, right? So lots of times, academic cultures, cultures that deal with science and education, are invested in praise. And let's change the word. Praise is the word Augustine used, but a modern equivalent would be prestige, right? It's super prestigious to be able to scan Aeschylus. And I'm putting it right there on my CV. And if anybody asks me to talk about it, I will. And I'll make you feel inferior. Prestige. It almost seems to be the coin of the realm in many universities, in many places of high culture. That has a snob value. Ever watch, probably never watched, the Marx Brothers' Night at the Opera. If you have, you'll know it's all about this, right? It's all about the opera as a, instead of as something you're supposed to have fun at, it becomes something like, oh, the opera's prestigious. You should go to the opera. Why? I don't like the opera. But it's it's very prestigious. So it's very difficult to avoid this kind of culture and adulation of prestige. Augustine gives an example in the De Doctrina. It has to do with the word for human being in Latin, which is homo. And it, when you want to say among or between human beings, you would say inter homines. But you could make a mistake by using the wrong Latin case and say inter hominibus. Ooh, that's embarrassing. It would be like if I said something like, Think of an example. Instead of saying that human being, I said something like that their human being, like a solecism or a kind of colloquialism. Like, I'd rather die than say that in front of you or than make a mistake of grammar. I don't care if what I'm saying is true. I don't want to be embarrassed. I want prestige. Ever read E.B. White's Elements of Style? I don't know if people read that anymore. But his very first one, or very near to it, was, if you don't know how to pronounce a word, say it loud. Why? Because if you say it loud, people will say, oh, that's how you say that word. But if you're like, people will know you don't know how to pronounce the word and you'll be embarrassed. Knowledge puffs up. Love builds up, St. Paul says, and Augustine quotes that. So the quest for prestige makes it hard to understand scripture, because we get blocked in using all the liberal arts. We get, instead of allowing them to go on to a higher conversation, we get blocked in how prestigious they are, and we stay there. We want the prestige, we want the long CV, we want shared professorships. I don't have one, by the way. But I want one. No. So that's why we need fear of God and piety to interpret scripture. Somehow we need to be taught to figure out how not to be fixated on prestige, how not to be fixated on praise, and move past it, put it in a different conversation. Augustine puts it this way: if you have piety, it'll mark all our knowledge with the sign of the cross, with the blood of the Lamb, so that it passes over, like the Israelites, into the promised land, into the true understanding of God's love as revealed in Scripture. If we offer ourselves and all our knowledge in humility, that knowledge will then help us understand what is above that knowledge, instead of blocking us. But if we're intent on being prestigious, we're going to get stuck there, and we're not going to be able to refer that in humility to something, think about it, friends, something which we could never give ourselves, something which we could never master. You don't master the love of God. You don't say, I'm the boss of the love of God. Hey, I got a PhD in the love of God. How's that? You don't say that. You say what? Thank you. You love me. I love you. Can you use the liberal arts and all your learning to say that better, to understand what it means more deeply? You have to be willing to enter a conversation which you can't master, because you're not the only one in it. God is in it. And God is giving you something you could have never gotten yourself, and you can't claim as a mark of prestige. Okay. Now I'm going to finally get to the confessions. You're probably thinking, is he ever going to get there? Whatever. Basically, friends, I'm going to rely on your recall of what you've read. I'm relying on your education. I'm not going to go over these passages in detail. I'm going to recall them to mind. But here's my idea. The confessions dramatizes, gives you a story, gives you a drama of Augustine's understanding of education and culture. He tells a story. And the De Doctrina that we've just been thinking about, he lays out the theory. But in the Confessions, he shows you what it looks like in real life. Not in theory, but in a real life, his own. For example, in one of the most famous passages at the end of book one, maybe you'll remember it, it's very vivid. He pictures a lawyer arguing with fury before a jury to send this guy to his death. And he's less afraid that he's sending a human being to his death, maybe even unjustly, than of making a mistake in speaking. Instead of saying inter homines, saying inter hominibus. The very example he gave in the De Doctrina. Friends, think about it. It's so plausible. It's so unbelievable, but it's so plausible, right? That someone would be more embarrassed to mispronounce a word or use the wrong grammar in making a speech than the person is in arguing a case that's unjust and that's going to send someone to their death. I'm not embarrassed about that. Who cares? But I am embarrassed if I mispronounce a word when I'm doing it. And let me tell you, friends, if I mispronounce the word right here and now in front of you, I'd be more embarrassed than if I made a factual mistake. How's that? Because you think, wow, that guy, is he really educated? He can't even talk. See how this quest for prestige? I want to be prestigious. I want to show you I know how to talk in very educated, eloquent ways. That's what I care about. See how the quest for prestige creates a sensibility that makes it so it's thinkable that you don't even care if you're sending someone to their death. All you care about is whether you're embarrassed or not. Want to hear another example from the academic life? Augustine doesn't put it in here. We academics, we read papers at places, right? Whatever. So what if I read a paper, and afterwards I go out into the hall, and there's somebody who's like saying, did you hear that great paper that Gerald Burisma gave? Or that Michael, and I want to say, wait a minute, I gave that paper. Like, why should I care? I care more that I get the credit than whether what I said was true. Who cares about that? I mean, Jill should have gotten the credit anyway, I'm sure, but the point is, I feel that. See, I don't just think it, I feel it. That's how deeply the quest for prestige forms our feelings, not just our thoughts. Augustine gives other examples. He talks about the teaching of Terence, the plays of Terence, where it pictures Zeus, Jupiter, thundering from on high, and he's actually committing adultery, couched in this language. And the comic line is, one guy in this play says, well, I can't imitate the thunderbolt, but I can imitate the other thing. And everybody's supposed to laugh. But Augustine's saying, look, he's not going to find fault with the literature. The words are beautiful, right? I'm not blaming the words, which are finely wrought precious vessel, but the wine of error mixed in for us in them by teachers who are drunk themselves. So with the teachers, see the point? They convey the love in which they are teaching the literature. So they love the adultery in the text. Yeah! Oh, sorry. They're into it. And they teach the students to be into it too, even as they're teaching the literature. So they're teaching the literature, which is beautiful, but they're also teaching a certain love, the reason they love the literature. They're not teaching neutrally. You can't use signs language neutrally. You always bring the love. You always form a culture in the love with which you're speaking. Sorry. There's another example, a famous one, maybe you'll remember it, in book one, where Augustine says, well, when I was in school, I was given an assignment. I had to memorize a certain passage in Virgil. And I memorized it so well that everyone started clapping. He remembers this very vividly. And they cried out in Latin, it's euge, euge. That means well done, yeah, well done. And he was like, well, so they cried it so loudly that I just loved it. Who could not want that? And so he went farther and farther into this culture of seeking praise or seeking prestige. He was getting pretty prestigious as a student. By the way, he tells you that, doesn't he? But the point is, he's not only learning the literature, he's learning to seek praise for knowing the literature at the same time. His education is both, right? So why would you learn literature? What's the motivation for it? Well, you could talk about truth and beauty and whatever. No, I'm learning it so people can clap for me. That's why. Got it? I don't care about truth and beauty. I care that somebody claps when I'm done. Got that? The point is, it can seem like the two are inextricable, that there's no other reason to be educated than to acquire prestige, than to want somebody to clap for you, metaphorically, to be impressed. Augustine says, I learned that in school. One other example. He recounts in book one another assignment that he received. If you're familiar with the Aeneid, you'll know that at the beginning of the Aeneid, Juno is all upset, and she wants to try to keep the Trojans from reaching Italy and founding Rome. It's a famous speech. And so he was given the job of giving a prose account, so writing a prose account of the poetry. And he lets you know that he won first prize, and glad of it, right? Well, why else would you excel? Why else would you seek excellence unless it's to be praised? And there's a serious question there, friends. Think about it in our culture. If there wasn't that motive, would people really excel? If there weren't going to be praised for it? It's a serious question now as it was then. Depends on how much you value that praise. Yeah, sorry, I just did that slide. Okay, so he says, small wonder then that I was swept off helplessly after profitless things and borne away from you, my God. The models proposed for me for imitation, the teachers, were people who would have been caught out and covered with embarrassment if they had related any of their doings, deeds not wrong in themselves, in a barbaric accent or with grammatical blunders. Whereas to relate licentious deeds in correct and well-turned phrases, in ample and elegant style, would have won them praise and honor. So the substance of the speech doesn't matter. If they were telling you true and edifying things, but made mistakes in grammar and syntax, they would be covered with embarrassment. But if they're talking about certain kinds of sexual exploits they were involved in, as long as they do it in polished and beautiful language, it's all they care about. That's a corrupt culture, right? That's focused, that has really replaced excellence with prestige. At one point he says, I mean, people are fond of thinking that Augustine is overreacting. There's one famous passage where in book one, he's reflecting on this and says, "O hellish river," I didn't put the passage up, "human children clutching their fees are still pitched into you since education is publicly touted in the forum." It's prestigious. You just see the picture of these like little boys, at that time it would be little boys, holding their fees to pay for school. And what they're going to be pitched into is this river, which is going to teach them to love prestige more than to love excellence, more than to love truth, more than to love God. Because you know what, friends? It's very easy to get good at using signs. It's not so good. It's not so easy to get good at reflecting on the things. It's very easy to use signs and use them to replace true excellence. But it's really hard to be truly excellent, truly virtuous. So friends, we can sum up the pathologies of culture, the pathologies of teaching, of education, as Augustine presents them in this way. I've already done it, but Augustine shows us a culture and an educational establishment that values prestige or praise over truth and excellence. The Latin word virtus, which is sometimes translated as virtue, actually means excellence. So the pursuit of excellence. Equally well, a culture which has confused excellence with prestige, substituting the latter for the former. So educational cultures, university cultures, not just university cultures, that forget that what's prestigious isn't necessarily what's excellent. Just because people who have degrees will say, this article that you submitted for publication is like the best thing since sliced bread, well, maybe it just conforms to trends. But they have prestige. They teach at certain places that everybody goes, whoa. Well, I don't want to name any places because you'll think I'm, never mind. But anyway, the replacement of excellence. We talk about the quest for excellence. Do we mean it? Or do we mean the quest for prestige? Which very subtly in our hearts and minds has replaced excellence. We've been trained to think that prestige is excellence. And friends, this is true. I'm almost finished, so don't worry. This is true even of the highest cultural achievement, philosophy. Philosophy, as Augustine sees it, can actually afford a glimpse, but still a glimpse, of God's transcendent nature. And you could think about it, right? Plato, maybe you've read the Symposium or parts of it, where Socrates talks about the ascent to beauty itself. You can glimpse it. You can touch that which is transcendent of all individual beauties. Philosophy helps you. You would think that that one thing wouldn't be able to be co-opted, right? Because it's bringing you into contact with God. Not in the same way Revelation does, but still it's authentic transcendence. But guess what, friends? That's the most tempting of all, right? Because think about it. A person like me, who has a PhD, as I told you before, and I'm reminding you again, and I'm somebody like me is like this. Aha, I have ascended through philosophy to the vision of God. Got that? Have you? I didn't think so. You know what? I've seen God. So you look at me and clap for me and take my classes and praise for me. In a way, friends, what you're tempted to do is to make God a credential on your CV. Yeah, God's on there. I mastered that. It's on there on the CV, like six or seven times to make sure you notice it. That's the height of pride, right? Because if God is a credential on my CV, if I've mastered God and I have the prestige of doing that, then I am God, in effect. And I want to be for you. I want you to see me and praise me, not the one I've seen. So it's ironic, but that very discipline that promises the glimpse of God is the one most susceptible to distortion by pride. And Augustine says, this is the kind of person he was becoming in book 7. You may remember, I had already begun to covet a reputation for wisdom, right? I'm wise, look at me. I was complacently puffed up with knowledge. Where was that love that builds up from the foundation of humility that is Jesus Christ? Augustine says, such people as he was becoming, yeah, they see the destination from afar. They see wisdom. They see the divine nature. They get a glimpse of it from far, far away, but they have no way to get there. In fact, they scorn the only way that is. Jesus Christ, who poured out his blood for us, right? What are you talking about? That guy, like he should have gotten a job. Like what happened to him? He got put on a cross, his blood spilled out all over the place. Ooh, that's wisdom? What are you talking about? I'm not going to have any. I'm a philosopher, for goodness sake. Socrates didn't, like, get all upset at the time of his death, the agony in the garden, whatever. Socrates, like, took it like a philosopher. So what's wrong with this guy? They are too scornful to learn from him, because he is gentle and humble of heart. And you have hidden these things from the sagacious and the shrewd and revealed them to little ones. What does all this unseemly blood have to do with wisdom? This is the culture built from pride. It becomes blind to revelation because it's not looking for humility. But friends, guess what? The good news is such a culture is never fully impervious, can never fully block revelation. It finds a way in. Here's how. This is a famous passage you might remember from Book 7. Your word, capital W, means the word, the second person of the Trinity, by which the whole world was created. Your word, the eternal truth, who towers above the higher spheres of your creation, has in these lower regions on earth built himself a humble dwelling from our clay, a flesh, and used it to cast down from their pretentious selves those who do not bow before him, and make a bridge to bring them to himself. He heals their swollen pride and nourishes their love, that they may not wander even farther away through self-confidence, but rather weaken as they see before their feet the Godhead grown weak by sharing our garments of skin, and wearily fling themselves down upon him so that he may arise and lift them up. So friend, this is the incarnation that he's talking about. Look how sneaky God is, according to Augustine, right? Very sneaky, because I'm a philosopher, right? Let's say I'm a philosopher, or whatever. I'm some kind of smart guy, professor. And I'm proud of it. But what if, like, who's the one who has the most prestige? Who could actually draw a lot of attention to himself if he felt like it? It's the eternal word. He's God. There's nothing higher. I'm trying to get there, but I'm trying to, like, push it aside. There's nothing higher. That's the most prestigious thing. What happens if he sneaks up on you? And is where you're looking up here, but all of a sudden it's, ooh, he's down there. He's the pavement under my feet. He came down here. You know what, friends? That could get to you, that story. That could, like, actually get to your heart. You could start thinking, he did that for me. And I've all this time been trying to forget about him, been trying to, but he actually bent down for me. You know what? You could get hooked. You could be moved. You could be tempted to say, thank you. Ooh, I forgot myself. I'm a prestigious professor. I'm not supposed to yell out thank you. Forget it, no. That's the whole point. In that moment, that little moment of conversion, you're tempted to forget about all your prestige and to forget about all your CV and to run after him. How do you do that? You run after him by getting baptized. Sorry, I should have put that slide up, but I didn't. I read it to you. You fling yourself down on him. You run after him. You pursue the thank you saying through the sacramental life by being baptized, which Augustine does in Book 9, and then in the Eucharistic life, which Augustine talks about in Book 10, if you recall. Here's the end of Book 10 to remind you. It's gorgeous, friends. See then, Lord. I cast my care upon you that I may live, and I will contemplate the wonders you have revealed. Okay, I will contemplate revelation. Your only Son, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, has redeemed me with his blood. Let not the proud disparage me, for I think about the price paid for me, that blood. I eat it. I drink it. I dispense it to others. That's the Eucharist, right? He's a bishop. And he's saying, I eat it, the body of Christ, I drink it, and I dispense it to others. And as a poor man, I long to be filled with it among those who are fed and feasted. And then do those who seek him praise the Lord. And friends, you'll remember that right after that passage in book 10, he goes on to books 11, 12, and 13. Sometimes undergraduates don't read these, but books 11, 12, and 13 are about the interpretation of Scripture. He takes on the first chapter of Genesis to interpret it. Now, right, he's ready. Now he's laid aside the pride, or he's working on laying aside the pride. This is a lifelong project. And he's, out of gratitude now, approaching the Scriptures with piety. Now it's very learned. Like, in case if you've read book 11, book 11 is about time. Ooh, that's a hard subject, time. And many people have misread book 11, thinking that this is just a philosophical treatise on time. It's not. It's a sophisticated reflection on time, but it's used to help the reader understand what Scripture says means when it says, in the beginning. We won't go into that now. But all this vast learning that Augustine has, now he's entered it into a different conversation. All the philosophy he knows, all the rhetoric he knows, now he's entering it into what the De Doctrina said, seeking to understand what's in Scripture and helping others to understand it. He's felt that urge to say thank you. Thank you. He's joined the church. He's become a Eucharistic person, living a Eucharistic life. And so now what? He wants to say thank you. He wants to tell people about the magnificent deeds of the Lord, what he's done for me, and to interpret the Scripture as a way of doing that. Wow, you did all this for me. It's really unprofessorial to say wow, in public especially. You did this all for me, thank you. I don't care. I forgot for a second myself. That's what confession is. Confession is this being willing to praise God, not just in the abstract, God is great, but in the concrete. You did this for me. Thank you, thank you, and thank you. I will never get to the end of saying thank you and of confessing your marvelous deeds unto your praise and helping others to do the same. That's Christian doctrine, doctrina. All right, friends, thank you.